What a joy to be here. I honor the worship team for coming to give their gift. Is my hand everything still where it was before we worshipped? And thank you for being here. Thank you for filling a room. And I cannot tell you how clearly the Lord showed that to me, how he was going, yes, they're coming. They're coming in a world where you could have been anywhere. You could have been making beautiful dresses. You could have been working on your beautiful new marriage. You could have been making delicious food. You could have been refining your art. And he said, you laid it all aside and you chose me. This morning, yesterday, so my Lisa child, is my second child, she's turning 10 tomorrow, but we had birthday party and everything. And yesterday, I was curling her hair for this. We went to go to the movies. If you ever want to know what the best birthday party is, it's going to the movies, because then your house doesn't get wrecked. Anyway, so I was particularly excited. And it's as if the Lord summed something up of what I want to share with you in that moment. And I said to her as I was curling her hair, I was like, these have just been the 10 most marvelous years to be your mommy. I can't believe you're mine. And if I flash over the last 10 years with her and we had a quick, like, oh, time's gone quickly, a really sentimental, warm moment, the Holy Spirit made me aware of the fact that in the last 10 years, I have had massive marital crises. I've had massive personal inner turmoil. In the last 10 years, gradually watched my mom deteriorate in dementia. We lost Willem's dad 2 months after Lisa was born, unexpectedly. We've had massive disappointments in friendship and church relationships. But when I stood with Lisa there doing her hair, none of that mattered. Everything pales. Everything is worth going through again to have this gift, to have this wonder, to have this warm, loving connection. You can give it all to me and more for what I experience in that. And in the moment when I confess to her, to know you and have you in my life, it's the best thing. These have been the 10 most radically awesome years of my life. I 100% meant that. And Holy Spirit said to me, that is knowing Jesus. In the light of who he is, in the light of the joy and the peace and the hope and the glory that he has revealed to me over the last 35 years. Sean, you had an idea of him through Bible stories before then. It makes it so worthwhile. And I want to start by telling you a story. Now, Ross is going to be grumpy with me. Not really. I don't think he gets too grumpy ever. But we're planning for the second half of the year, and for one of our topics, he said, but look into the Moravian revival. Now, some of you helped us at Kids Ministry 2 years ago, and we touched on that revival. But I went into it, and the message at the end of the year will be that it leads you to the missions ground. But as I read the story of revival and I compared it to Acts 13, where the first missions group was sent out to, Paul and Barnabas were sent out officially for the first time, like, this is a mission, we feel called, the Holy Spirit says we must go, we see incredible similarities. We see a bunch of people that in the commotion and the busyness of a town and in life stopped and came together. The Moravians specifically were a bunch of, they were from the Czech Republic. They were being persecuted. There had been a man that came against the big church of the time, the medieval church, and they said, no, there's stuff that you're teaching wrong, and there's all sorts of clauses and weird stuff that you're putting into religion that's not true. And when he stood up against them, there was incredible persecution of the church, and he was burnt at the stake. And I can't remember John, someone. And then the Christians spread. And up until Acts, that was also pretty much how the gospel spread, is people ran for their lives. They say you've got two kinds of missions, the run for your life mission and the led by the Spirit mission, and that up till then it was run for your life missions. Anyways, and in Germany, there's a young man, Count Zinzendorf. Did somebody just say his name before I did? Or did it just echo back at me? Anyways, yeah, you guys, I'm sure somebody knew it. And this young man, he inspired me. So he, as a four-year-old little boy, committed his life to the Lord. And he said, I'm going to live for Jesus. Because Jesus lived for me. And then there's another account where he was in Paris, but now he's a wealthy young man with influence and property, and he's in Paris, I assume, on some form of holiday, and he's standing below a picture of Christ, and underneath it says, this I have done for you, what have thou done for me? And that day, this young man decides there's no other way to live but for Jesus. And that becomes his life mission, is I live for Jesus. He goes back home to his beautiful property, and these refugees come flooding in to Germany, and he takes one family in of Moravians, and they start praying together, and this one family would turn into 300 families that he would make a little, they would create a little village, and there they would live together. The problem is, they all came from the same place with the same, I love Jesus and I don't want to compromise and get up to the nonsense and preferably not be burnt at the stake. So they have that in common. But now they come and they all come from other denominations and other revelations of what Jesus says about this and what we should do about this and how we should baptize and how we should do this. And there's constantly this grumbling and fighting, full on fighting. And despite prayer meetings and Bible study and everything, this continues. And they eventually call an all-night prayer. And these men and women come together, and they start praying. And there, I just want to get to the beautiful worship or the hymn that came from there. The Holy Spirit was poured out. A one-night prayer meeting turned into 110 years of 24-hour prayer. Are you ready? You guys aren't in a rush to go anyway. You realize every time you come to church, you must come with that kind of expectation. And you're like, Amal, you don't know my boss. I'm like, if you're working for Jesus, 110 years, non-stop prayer. And from there, missions teams went, and they say the Moravian movement revival would have been the biggest denomination ever had it not been that they gave away all the churches they planted. That impressed me. The 110 years impressed me even more. But the one thing that blew my mind, and if you've been in church communities or in just a normal family or you've worked with a bunch of people, you know the miracle of what this requires. So something that flowed from this revival was many hymns. But I want you to listen to this hymn's words. I'll spare you. I don't know the tune, so I won't sing it. They walked with God in peace and love, but failed with one another. While sternly for the faith they strove, brothers fell out with brother. But he in whom they put their trust, who knew their frames that they were dust, pitied and healed their weakness. He found them in his house of prayer, with one accord assembled, and so revealed his presence there. They wept with joy and trembled. One cup they drank, one bread they broke, one baptism shared, one language spoke, forgiving and forgiven. Then forth they went with tongues of flame, in one blessed theme delighting, the love of Jesus and his name, God's children all uniting. That love our theme and watchful still, the law of love may we fulfill, and love as we are loved. In that room where there was such disunity and strife, and my opinion is better than your opinion, and you have a bigger revelation of the Holy Spirit than I have, and da-da-da-da-da. The miracle of unity happened. The miracle of love between people that are different and couldn't sit around the same table. Count Zinzendorf's last words on his bed speak so powerfully to me. I am going to my Savior. I am ready. There's nothing to hinder me now. I cannot say how much I love you all. Who would have believed that they prayed of Christ, that they all, believed that the prayer of Christ, that they all be one, could have been so strickenly fulfilled amongst us. I only asked for the first fruits amongst the heathen, and thousands have been given me. Are we not as in heaven? Do we not live together like angels? The Lord and his servants understand each other. I am ready. I don't know about you, but I know there are moments, one specifically with my little Lisa the other day, where you are so aware of the goodness and the love between us that I am sure that must be the feeling, the overwhelming feeling in heaven. It is well with you and me and us. And we have an understanding that we are here for the same good, for the same reason. When last did you have that feeling of this must be like heaven? God saying this can be like heaven. Coming here and looking into your brothers and sisters' eyes. I always say to Lisa, she's a little bit like being in heaven. She's my child. She's not competitive. She's not too noisy. No, she is a bit noisy sometimes. She shrieks. But she's always looking for the good. She's very kind. She's gentle. She's funny. And God wants us to consider what makes a community like that. And then on the other hand, what makes it hellish? I want you to consider those relationships that you're in where you just come closer and you're like, oh, here I'm going to be judged. Here I'm going to get a harsh word. Here I am not going to be accepted without my mask. I've got a beautiful friend. She is one of my biggest inspirations for for transformation. She has a very typically, what do you call a very feisty personality? That person that always has an opinion, always speaks the loudest and the longest. She was head girl, and if somebody had to be president, you'd most probably suggest her because she'd get things done. Do you know people like that? Can it be tough being around people like that? No? Okay. All the guys that are like that, you're like, ah. And we know enough about personality types to know that those personalities are necessary and that the society will come to a grinding halt without them. We know that God made us all different and we were created for different things. But this friend of mine says again to me this week, she says, my greatest prayer is I used to be a knife. And wherever I went, I pierced, I cut, and I hurt. And sometimes with very godly intentions. And she says, all I want to be is an oak tree. And to watch this woman transform intentionally, with a great desire to reflect God, she says, do you know what my greatest desire is? Is for people to feel safe around me. Do people feel safe around you? Can people take a breath when they're with you? The problem is we can try and morph ourselves into this, and my friend's a beautiful example of going, God, I can't change myself. But I will be very practical about how I apply my scripture. And I'll surround myself with kind-hearted, spirited people so that I can learn. And I'll be quiet when I used to speak, and I'll use my self-discipline. But she will tell you, if she testifies here in front, that it takes a work of the Spirit. It takes a desire to want to be like Christ. And what we see in the book of Acts, and what we see in a little town in Germany, is a bunch of people that drew close. And both those encounters, the intention of the prayer night was to worship God. To make God big, to see God. And in that night, they get a revelation through Holy Spirit of who Jesus is. And my very strong thesis, maybe I should go and do something smart and go and write a thesis, is that if you have the bigger your revelation of Jesus, and can we remember we're speaking about Holy Spirit, his number one job, his passion, his joy, look, there's Jesus. My theory is that if Jesus is revealed to you, and you consider him day and night, and you consider his otherness to any power or principality or ruler or thing pulling you from him or from his kingdom, if you consider him, you will transform. You will not transform by sheer willpower. And that's why nights like this evening are precious. When men and women have prepared beautifully to take you into the throne room. And you know how excited Holy Spirit gets. Philippians 3:20-21 says, but our citizenship is in heaven, and from it we await our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our lowly body to be like his glorious body by the power that enables him even to subject all things to himself. I prayed that earlier. But what I love about that and the other revivals I looked at, and I read through Acts this week, I see people that are different, radically different. But I see people that are walking together. I see power. Armour Kennedy preached this morning, and I encourage you to go listen to the YouTube recording. There's power, there's a manifestation of God's power and desire to establish his kingdom through his people. And there's, did I say, love, power, and togetherness. Whether in Revelation, or whether in Acts, or whether it's a group of people called Israel, God might highlight one or two people's stories, but ultimately their story is there to echo a group story. And the group is there to tell of the one that created them. There's a beautiful picture there of three women weaving a tapestry. And when I got it, I said, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Because can we consider how profound that is? And we can all consider in our own hearts, what are we experiencing Holy Spirit saying to us? But if we look at that carpet and we say that is the Garden of Eden, and the end of that carpet is Jesus' return. There is three in one, a God that is busy intricately weaving us together. That those baskets full of wool are unimpressive and not very valuable. But when they are woven together, when they are placed in the hands of the triune God, they become something magnificent. And we go to Jesus' prayer that Count Zinzendorf alludes to in John 17:11. Do you know if Jesus prayed something that's kind of important? If Jesus prays something, it's kind of important that we pray it too. This morning, Amu said you get different kinds of people in the body of Christ. You get the love people. Like, just if you just love everyone. That used to be me. Obsessed with just loving. Can't we just, and we can justify it with mercy orientated and kinderkerktannie and everything. And then you get the power people. They tend to be those slightly prickly people with big personalities that want to make an impact in the kingdom, and it's all about power. But I'm becoming a new kind of person. Because every time I open this scripture, and I want to challenge you, go and test me on this, because it's going to run strong next semester. Second half of the year, whatever that is. Our God desires unity. If you are not getting along with your brothers and sisters in church, it's not this that, Danny, I'm unhappy with how you spoke to me yesterday. Why aren't you nice to me? Why didn't you invite me to a braai? No. Fall on your knees. God, I love Danny, and you prayed. You prayed, let us be one. But God, there's something between us. God, my heart is as hard as a rock. I repent for holding bitterness and anger towards her. Forgive me. Because I want what you want, Jesus. I want what you want, Father. I want to represent Jesus well, Holy Spirit. Empower me. When you come through those church doors, evaluate what's happening in your heart. What's happening in your heart between you, me, and Rena is very important. What's happening between me and anyone else in this church really matters. But most of the time, what is happening is it's loosening up a bunch of wounds and unmet needs in my heart. And then I walk into the church community and I'm like, this hurts. Well, this is uncomfortable. And then all of a sudden, an evening that was meant to come and lift my gaze out of the muck of life to Jesus and consider his glory and power becomes a wound licking evening. Is it just me that can relate? Just me. Okay.
You guys are not very like making me feel better about how I sometimes walk into church. Let's quickly read our anchor scripture. 1 Corinthians 12, 12 to 14. For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many are one body, so it is with Christ. For in one spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and all were made to drink of one spirit. For the body does not consist of one member, but of many. If God says you were created for good works, if God says he poured his spirit into Nicole, then all I can do is celebrate her. She is made in the image of God. She's filled with his spirit. She's a temple of the living God. And what I'm here to do is to encourage her. And if I'm the rots, the steen, the help me with a brick in the building that we are busy building, that God says we are part of, then all I have to consider is it easy? Is it easy to lie on top of me, or have I become all edgy and uncomfortable? Am I edging myself out of church? Am I full of the Holy Spirit? Am I full of God? Am I full of hope? Do I know what my role is in the kingdom of God so that Nicole can get on and do what she needs to do? Or otherwise, we're going to end up in contention and competition. And when she opens a new school, and I'm going to go like, oh, maybe I should have done that. So glorious, helping kids in need. And then she walks in, and I've got an attitude, and I get to celebrate her. When last did you walk up to someone and just get excited about them, that they could see the delight in your eyes? Because you know their story, you know how profound they are, without expecting anything back. Because God is our sufficiency. And we say that, but we don't live that. God is the builder of ministries. We say that, but do we believe it? God is the one that directs our paths. Do we say it or do we believe it? But he fills us with our spirit, with his spirit. Last week, and that's the last thing before I let you ask the worship team to come forward again. 2 weeks ago, I can't remember. We spoke about the Holy Spirit making us holy. And the impression I got was of the temple, that God says we are now the temple, but the temple, the traditional temple, had an outer court. It had an inner court. And it had the Holy of Holies. But I said, this outer court in so many ways represents our flesh. It represents the tugging of the world. It represents what the outside world sees of what's going on inside here. It really matters what's happening outside here. And one of the biggest things that is happening outside here is how you relate. And when we look at that wall and we see that it's one of the most cardinal things, you can all have a look, known by a love. You won't be known for how big your ministry is, how big your bank balance is. God is going to know, we are going to be known for how much you love the man and the woman sitting to the left and the right of you. And that's really going to matter when you stand before God one day. Oh. I want to quickly close our eyes and I'm not going to. Worship team, would you mind coming forward? I've got a bit of a prophetic thing that I want to do.
So, what was that song Tian we sang just now at intercession? Help me. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Okay, so I was a foundation phase teacher, and so there's something about us doing things prophetically that I understand why God wants us to do it. I understand why we have bread and why we have wine to remind us, literally how it affects our brain and how it allows us to consider something that is abstract, practically is very good for us. So this evening, I want us to consider what happened in Germany. I want us to consider what happened in Acts 13, where a bunch of people, ordinary people, came and said, we love Jesus. I want to consider that also in this front court is where the place Jesus came in, and he threw tables over and he said, my house is a house of prayer. You have made it a den of robbers. Wheeling and dealing, he made whips and he didn't like it. And I want us to turn to this God that really cares about how we go about our lives, how we treat our brothers and sisters. And then I want us to consider the Holy Spirit. Because the Moravians and Count Zinzendorf, Paul and Barnabas could only do so much in their own strength. When Jesus left, he said, I'm sending you someone better because you're going to need him. And then he built his church. And indirectly he's saying, you're going to need each other. So I'm going to start on this side. And I need you guys, if you're sitting by yourself, to just go sit next to someone else. And we are going to put oil as a symbol. It's not the Holy Spirit. It's a symbol of the Holy Spirit. On our hands. I'll start there on the two sides and maybe in the middle. And I want us, I'll drop a few, and everyone by the end of the day must go and get some oil from somebody else's hand. And then we're going to sing a song that Tian's going to lead us in that he doesn't know about. And then we're going to worship one more song. And if you have hurt in your heart, hurt that started maybe as a child because you struggled in your family, could you really struggle to trust people? Maybe you've been really hurt by people here that have been careless. And it's valid hurt. I want you to bring those hurts before God today. And I want you to consider giving them over to him, so that God can restore to us something of heaven. When brothers and sisters can dwell together and the Holy Spirit can reveal Christ to us. And in his presence, there's freedom, there's joy, there's hope.